Expense reporting templates in Excel. Look, if you're going to do it, you got to knock it out of the park. It's got to be very, very easy to use. It's got to be intuitive. It's got to get you what you need in accounting. And honestly, it's got to be slick. There's a lot of reporting applications out there. You don't want to hear people complaining that they're using Excel. Well, what we do today is going to be very, very nifty, and we're going to check all those boxes. I'm Kyle with The Technical Accountant. Let's go. All right, so what we're starting with here, this is nothing crazy. I'm pretty sure every person watching this video can put together in their mind what an expense reporting template should look like. You know, it's pretty basic stuff. A lot of these fields, these were pulled from an actual expense reporting application. But again, you know, it's just the date. It's, you know, what is the expense? It's the type here. Where are we expensing this to? Is it a department? Is it a specific location? Whatever it is, the vendor description notes, receipt. We'll talk about that. Miles, mileage amount, you know, some basic stuff here. One thing that's kind of important. So anytime you're creating a system for somebody else, especially operations or, you know, the people out there that don't really care about the details that accounting does care about, give them some instructions. So very, very basic, very easy to do here. So look, hey, just a reminder, expenses over $25 require a receipt. Make sure you get an approval before you submit this to accounting. So, you know, use simple tools like that. But again, if we're going to do this in Excel, if we're going to create an expense reporting template system in Excel, it's got to be slick. It's got to be user-friendly. So let's talk about those details. So first thing, we'll just go left to right here. So date. Well, we don't want someone putting in garbage. So we're going to use data validation right off the rip here to make sure that, hey, look, we're looking for a date here. We don't want you to put in your favorite color. Put in the date. So to do that, data validation. And you see we're selecting allow only a date, and we can actually put in the date that we want them to use. So just saying anything greater than 1/1/2022, fantastic. Basic stuff, but again, we want to keep the data clean that's coming through and make it easier on the user to use. Where it gets cool here, let's go into the expense type. I prefer to just make the expense type a drop-down list. You could do this a little differently. I could create a different column, say, look, if it's a meal, put it in this column. If it's a mileage, put it in this column. If it's airfare, put it in this column. But then you might have 30 different columns. A drop-down list is very easy to use in Excel. With drop-down lists, again, we can make sure the data that they're putting in is correct, and we make it easy on the user to pick it. So let's go here. I'm gonna go ahead and say, let's do 12/31/23, my expense type. This is a drop-down list. So if I just say it is a, let's do an airfare expense. You see over here, we have the miles section. That's now blanked out. We'll get to it. So airfare expense, but how this works is I've actually created this tab called lookups, and we can hide this tab before you send it out to the users. But for now, I'm just gonna leave it showing here. So lookups here, and all of my expense types, airfare, car rental, cell phone, entertainment, meals, etc. It's all listed in this list. So it requires them to pick one of the predefined options. We don't want them putting in something completely random because again, it means nothing to us in accounting. So again, creating this lookup list, put our values just over here in the separate tab. Again, we can hide this and we can see that. And then what you do is we're actually gonna go back up here to the data validation. And then instead of this time selecting date, which we saw back in the prior column, I'm actually selecting list, and then it says, okay, what is your source? Why wouldn't I select all my potential options? You see, I left a blank here because we want to make sure they can leave a blank. So that's why you see going all the way down to A15, hit okay, and now again, cell phone, whatever. It's here, it's evident what they have to select from. Same thing for department. So this could be department, this could be location, this could be anything meaningful to them or to accounting that we want them to put in with each one of their expenses. So for this one, I'm just selecting, it could be for all, it could be for accounting, and same concept here. I created a lookup list over here in my lookups tab, all departments, executive operations, and again, I selected that blank. So if we go back up here, data validation, lookups, going over to lookup tab, there you go. Vendor, standard stuff, description, standard stuff, added comments, very standard stuff. I like this one as well. So we actually added the note here, expenses greater than $25 require a receipt. Well, let's let the user tell us whether or not the receipt is going to be included, whether or not we should expect it, or if they completely missed it, whatever it is. Same thing again. Again, I created a lookup list here. Options, yes, no. So with each expense, okay. Nope, no receipt on this one, none on this one, etc. Now the miles, this is cool. This is where we're going to use conditional formatting. You see, I selected airfare, so my miles column here went black. If I select mileage, it now becomes active, and then you also see this amount column went inactive. You'll see why. So miles, so let's go ahead and let's say 22 miles. Well, the current mileage rate is 62.5 cents per mile. Also, very easy to maintain. I'm going over to my lookups tab here. Just have the mileage rate, 62.5 cents. So that is an automatic calculation. That's nothing crazy. So what I'm basically saying is I6 times my lookup C2, the 62.5, and that's going to give us our 1375. You'll also see that I added an if statement to the beginning here. And what I'm saying here is basically if the field is mileage, do this formula. If it's not mileage, if it's anything else, I just want this to be blank. If you didn't put in that if statement there, if I didn't put in, make it blank here, what you're going to see is a bunch of zeros, a bunch of weird stuff that the user might look at and say, what is that? So again, we don't want anything confusing for the user. So that's why we use the if statement to basically say specifically, if it's not mileage, make the field blank. No dashes, no zeros, nothing. Now the conditional formatting, let's get into that. So what I'm going to do, I'm going to go back to my home tab, conditional formatting. And you'll see, you know, if you never looked in here before, it gives you a couple different options. Highlight this cell if it's less than zero, whatever the option is. But we're going to do something a little more creative. So I'm going to go to new rule, or in this situation, I'm going to manage rule. I already created it. You'll see what we're doing here, though. So if you select a new rule, it brings up this window. I'm going to use a formula to determine how to format this cell. And what I'm saying is I'm actually created, it's got two criteria. It says if C6 does not equal mileage and C6 is not blank, then make this field black. So it's kind of some reverse logic there. But basically, if we select mileage, we want this field to basically be active. If I select anything else, taxi fare, whatever, I want this field to basically blank out. There's not a good way to remove the values in the field. So what we can do is we could shade this white. It just lets them know, hey, look, this is not correct. And you also see that the formula itself dropped out of the bottom here so that it doesn't even give them a mileage rate at all. So that's black. Well, we know that needs to be blank. So again, let's go back here. Let's select mileage. The field is now active. Let's go back in and put in our 20 miles in. There's our 1250. And at the same time, so since this is a mileage, we're going to use the same thing, conditional formatting on the amount field. This one's a little more easy to follow. So again, let's go to new rule. Let's go to manage rules. I see my rule here. And I'm saying if C6 is mileage, make this field black. Very simple, very straightforward. Makes it black, makes the text white. Text white is just telling them that, hey, this should not be here. Hit OK. You'll also see all of my fields here are colored. So I could have gone in, I could have selected each one of these fields, and I could have said, all right, we'll make this one, you know, light blue, make this one light blue, etc. Another fantastic conditional formatted option that I always use, I use it very, very frequent, is select your area. Let's go back to conditional formatting. New rule, again, manage rule, I've already created it. See, I've got a ton here. This is a formula. You can download this spreadsheet at the end of this video. It'll be available. This is one you can just write down. Very useful. We can use it all the time. Basically, you drop in this formula, equals mod row 2 equals 0. I don't actually know the details of what that means, but I do know it's very useful. And what it'll do is it'll automatically shade every other line that you have selected. So that's a conditional formatting that I have selected, and that's why all of these were automatically shaded. So let's move on to the next section here. So I think the biggest drive homes with what we just covered is going to be the drop-down list and the conditional formatting. Very cool. Makes it very straightforward for the user and prevents them from screwing up. The next thing is, again, think about just, it's all about the user. We want this to be as easy as possible, because if it's not, they're going to hate it. That's just the way it is. Anyone that's worked in accounting long enough knows this. So let's do a few things here. So again, when we send out this spreadsheet to the user, let's make it look as clean as possible. So I'm going to go up here to the View tab. Let's get rid of the grid lines. Let's get rid of the headings. So that'll take away our columns and our row numbers. And let's actually get rid of the formula bar. They don't need to know that. They're just going to open this up. They're going to type in Walmart, and that's all they need to do. Don't let it feel so much like Excel. Using these quick, simple options is a great way to do that. Also, let's think about if they do choose to print this, it's going to happen. It is not going to be required for the way we're setting this up, but if they do choose to print it, let's go to page layout. Let's make the margins as small as possible. Let's make the orientation landscape. You're going to have more size here for landscape versus portrait. And then last thing, if you come down to the page break preview, you can take this hard blue line and you can draw it right up against the template itself. So normally it'll be out here or it might be way down. It's going to have a bunch of page breaks in between. So again, let's just drag it right up to where we want this to actually print. So that way, if it is printed, it's going to look pretty darn good on paper. And now the last thing as far as functionality is going to go in this spreadsheet, let's go back to our main view here. We're going to use security in Excel to really dummy-proof this. We don't want people messing up the formulas. We don't want people clicking and putting information in random spots. With Excel, being able to lock down fields is incredibly simple. Every field that you look at, by default, is locked down. So if I right click it, I hit format cells. If I go to protection here, it's locked. So when I actually lock down this spreadsheet, it's going to be locked by default. So let's hit okay. So anything that I want to unlock for the user, so I want to unlock everything except for the calculation here. I right click this section, format cells, and I would select unlocked. So same goes for the amount. Let's unlock it. I would unlock the signature field, unlock the name, the dates, etc. Once I have all my fields locked and unlocked, what you do before you actually start distributing this out to the masses is let's go up to review and hit protect sheet. And you'll see some pretty straightforward options here. Do you want to give them the ability to even select those locked cells? They can't do anything with them anyway, so I'm going to go ahead and say, no, if it's locked, you basically can't do it. So they can't even select the formula field here. They can't select the totals down here at the bottom. They can't select them. However, they can select the unlocked cells. Of course, that's the whole point. We want them to be able to select and utilize those unlocked cells. So once I have those two settings, those are really the only two that I really care about. Just sticking a very generic dummy password. If you're worried about forgetting this password, I would actually just consider putting it on the lookups tab over here. The idea isn't to make this Fort Knox security. The idea is to deter people from using this incorrectly and just make it more evident what they're actually supposed to do. Now, as far as actually using this in a real world, a real business setting, there's a couple things I recommend. I'm a huge proponent of keeping things electronic. I don't really want people to reprint this and stapling all the receipts to the back. So what I would suggest, not required, create these tabs are already on here. What these tabs show is it shows each individual expense from the front here. One, two would show two. And then what the user can do is, you know, just like if they were using an expense reporting application, you input your expense line information and then you have to add the receipt. So I've got expense line one, they click on tab one, they can copy and paste the receipt, they can insert from a file. If they're using Excel on their phone, it's very easy to upload a picture directly on this tab. You give them a couple of best practices, just kind of going through their options on the easiest way to get it in. Again, we got to keep this very dummy proof, very easy for the users to use. So tab per expense, great way to do. And then really what I guess I ultimately suggest as far as distributing this report, they could save this file, everyone could have a local copy. But that's not ideal. Anytime you want to make changes, obviously, then people got the old file, they don't have the new template, they don't have the new expense types listed. I suggest saving this on a shared file folder, wherever you use at your company, whether it be OneDrive, Teams, SharePoint 365, good old file servers, save it somewhere, and then distribute a link. In my situation, I've got it saved in OneDrive. So I'm gonna hop over to my OneDrive. Here's my expense reporting template. I can share this. Anyone with the link can edit, of course, that's the whole point. We want them to be able to edit, and that's it. Basically, you hit copy. It's gonna give you a link, and then I could take this link and I can email out to all users, say, hey, bookmark this somewhere. They could actually bookmark this on their browser. How are you getting information to your users? It could be SharePoint, it could be Meta's workplace, whatever it is. Give them this link. That way they've always got the most up-to-date copy, and it's a click away from them to find this very important expense reporting template. And that wraps this one up. The main focus is here, keep it very, very user-friendly, make it dummy-proof, and get you the information that you need in accounting. We have taken Excel and we've created what looks and feels like a real expense reporting application. If you like this video, consider giving it a thumbs up, consider subscribing. Plenty more accounting related tech videos coming your direction. I'm Kyle with The Technical Accountant. See you next time.